and gentlemen. If I could have everyone's attention, please. Appreciate everyone coming out this evening. And considering that this is our January Meeting Chamber of Commerce board meeting, just like every other board meeting, we need to call this board. So I'll officially call this board meeting to order. And I'll ask Angela.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Thank you so much for being here tonight. Good evening, distinguished guests, chamber members, board of directors, and elected officials. I would like to start by stating it is an honor to stand before you as your president of the Eaton North Carolina Chamber of Commerce. Great things happen when there's a gathering of great minds. And it's with great anticipation that we welcome all of you this evening. We've all chosen to be a part of our association because of our mutual passion for the city of Eaton. A new dawn, a new day, a new year for Eaton and its residents. Your passion helps us all to come together as one, and the energy we create as a community allows us to achieve our individual as well as group goals. We need you as much as you need us, and this is why we are so happy to have you all join us here tonight. One ground rule, please, anyone who speaks, keep your remarks to 3 to 5 minutes, except, of course, our keynote speaker, because we want to hear what you have to say. We are so honored to have Chris Ellington in the house this evening, UNC Healthcare CEO for Network Hospital, UNC Healthcare, excuse me. Also, we'd like to thank our board for their continued support and volunteer efforts of our chamber. We really appreciate you. And we want to thank you for giving life again to Eden and our hospital. Thank you very much for that. We also want to thank our sponsors for believing in and supporting our chamber. All of our sponsors are listed on this board, our community sponsors, and we really appreciate their support. It's all about support. We want to thank Debbie's Catering tonight for their delicious offerings. The hors d'oeuvres were very yummy. Just wait until dinner. We also would like to thank the Eden Ballroom, Janet Medina, and Isidro Medina for allowing their venue for us and their wonderful decorations. We'd also like to thank Glenn Denny for his musical selections. And I would like to say a special thank you to my communications assistant, Heather Castle. She is my right hand. Also, I'd like to thank the wonderful Randy Hunt for sharing last year with me. We both served as president of the Eaton Chamber last year. And thank you, I have a wonderful person to follow, and everyone loves you, and I can only hope that they would like me as much. And without further ado, I'd like to welcome to the stage one of our executive board members, Mr. Phillip Raeburn, who will honor us with an invocation before dinner. Thank you.
Lord, we love you. We thank you so much for just being in this room tonight. We want to honor you in our speaking. We want to honor you in our eating. We know that you are Lord of us. So as we eat and continue tonight, bless us and bless this food. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I have told several people here this evening that we will try to get this over with, get you out of here real quick. I know that there's something on TV tonight that everybody is dying to get home and see, that all the national and international media and television and everybody in the world is going to be covering it. And I know you want to get home and see the photos of the blue moon and the lunar eclipse and the super moon. So I'll be sure to make that happen for you guys. We've got several awards to give out this evening. So at this time, I'd like to ask you to silence your cell phones. Cause as little distraction as possible. Our first award, we'll just jump right into it, will be the Business of the Year Award. Now, this year's Business of the Year goes to a business that provides support to this community 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. Although they opened in Eaton 9 years ago, the company was originally established in 1952. The convenience they offer to our community includes made-to-order foods, specialty coffees, and so many variations of fuel that I'm not even sure what kind of car they would all go in. They make it well known that they not only wish to be located in a city, but they want to support the community through donations of goods and services. They were a major sponsor of this year's Temptations in the Garden event and provided delicious samples of what seemed like their entire store. My pleasure this year to announce Sheets as the Eaton Chamber of Commerce Business of the Year. Please join me in congratulating store manager Beverly Reynolds and Kelly Fowler as they come up to accept the award. You might not recognize Beverly. She doesn't have her hat on, but it's her. She got a long walk. We can pass it back. Well, actually, that might clear the house. All right, we'll move right along. Director of the Year. Director is a member of the Eaton Chamber of Commerce Board. Yes, the Director of the Year is an award that's voted on by their fellow board members. So it carries a little cloud. 2017 Director of the Year goes to an individual who has been on the Chamber Board for 2 years and on the Executive Board for both years as well. He's a certified tax preparer for 10 years and a franchise owner of several Liberty Tax Service businesses in Rockingham and Stokes County. He stepped right into the Chamber of Finances. He's done a fantastic job. J.R. Cecil joined the Chamber in 2012 and has been extremely active ever since. Most recently, J.R. participated in the 7-hour marathon Get Fit Eaton Boat Race. And I believe you came in first, didn't you? You rubbed that in second place, people are here. Participated in the Temptations in the Garden event and planning the layout of our chamber directory. JR supports the chamber by attending all monthly meetings, chamber coffees, lunch and learns, and ribbon cuttings that he can. This year, JR Liberty Tax Service is a community sponsor of the chamber as well. Chamber is definitely better for having an individual of JR's caliber on the board. We really appreciate all his service, dedication to the chamber he's provided. Come on up, JR, and dance like one of those Statue of Liberties. Out there. Presented to an individual that the chairman feels has best exemplified the mission of the chamber. This individual has done this in a manner That would have never even crossed my mind. She has involved local high school students in numerous chamber activities. By doing this, Christy Hensley has not only given students at Moorhead High School opportunities to learn about local business outside of their school lives, but at the same time has allowed them to share some insight into many interesting programs being offered at Moorhead High School with our local community. If children are our future, Christy goes above and beyond preparing them for us. In her 4 years at Moorhead High School as the Career Development Coordinator, she works with the Career and Technical Education courses, placing student interns in numerous local businesses. Many of you here tonight may have had the opportunity to provide an internship for some of her students. By bringing these students to events such as Chamber Coffees, she encourages the students to interact with local business that helps them choose their career paths and find what they may be most passionate about in the workplace. This will be Christy's third year on the Chamber Board and her first year on the Executive Board. Thanks to Christy, this Chamber School partnership she has created has been very beneficial to both parties, and the Chamber is very excited to be involved in this. Please join me in congratulating Christy Hensley as the recipient of this year's Chairman's Star.
Beautification in the form of landscaping, facade improvements, interior renovation, or overall appearance of the property. These businesses and property owners improve the appearance of the whole community by improving and keeping their properties attractive and beautiful. This year, as in years past, there were many deserving nominees. This business owner recently completed a total interior and exterior renovation of their downtown property. This renovation represents a great investment in the local community and has totally transformed an entire block of one of the downtown areas. In 2014, this business owner moved her studio into the upstairs of a downtown building. As her business grew, she saw the need to expand into her own space. She bought three adjoining buildings that were recently purchased after standing vacant for more than 10 years. She took the renovations to the next level, adding spacious offices, a large shooting area, a client viewing room, framing room, kitchen, and even a fully equipped salon. Her vision is an inspiration for anyone that cherishes a vibrant downtown. In recognition of this investment in the Eden community and the remarkable transformation to the downtown area and the overall appearance of the Eden community, the Chamber Award for the Community Appearance is presented to Ashley Latham Photography.
May 5th, 2017, might not instantly register with many what its significance is. For those who live or have a business in a certain area of Eden, they will immediately recognize its significance. For on this date, at 3:18 a.m., Eden Police Officer Yavira Dockery uttered one single word to the 911 Communications Center, tornado. An EF1 tornado with maximum winds of 110 miles an hour cut a path 375 yards wide for 3.3 miles through residential and business districts of our city. 6 minutes on the ground is all it took to damage or destroy 39 structures, with an additional 139 properties suffering various levels of downed debris and several months worth of cleanup behind. We're extremely fortunate as a community to have no deaths or injuries related to this event. With power outages and streets impassable, city officials immediately sprung into action, walking the streets throughout the night with flashlights, checking on residents, and assessing the damage. While we take this opportunity to thank the city for leading recovery efforts, the city wants to say thank you to all of the individuals, agencies, organizations, and businesses that assisted them in their response to this devastating event. The response and recovery effort was both extensive and exhaustive. City officials and emergency services spent countless days working over and above long hours, assisting all of those affected. In the end, 20,000 cubic yards of debris was collected, ground, and hauled away. Just to give you a vision of what 20,000 cubic yards is, imagine the Carolina Panthers football stadium, the actual grass bin area, and imagine debris piled just over 10 feet high. That's how much debris was ground and hauled away just from this tornado. Tonight, the Eden Chamber of Commerce would like to recognize and say thank you to the following individuals for your efforts during this event. So with the following individuals, please come forward. With the Eden Fire Department, Chief Tommy Underwood and Deputy Chief Todd Horton. With the Eden Police Department, Chief Greg Light and former Chief Reese Burton. Ashley, check the name on your award. Randy Hunt had one job. I mean, yeah, apparently they weren't too strong. You needed a stronger. Unless you started working with the police department. With Municipal Services Call District. And representing City Hall, City Manager Brad Corcoran and Mayor Neville Hall. But in addition to these individuals, I want to recognize the following guys and their crews for the efforts that they put out. And these are guys that are superintendents with municipal services. You've got Darren Gatewood over the streets, Rodney Carter over solid waste, Jason Bernard over fleet maintenance, Daryl Tilley over collection and distribution, Ray Thomas, facilities and grounds, and Mark Bullens, construction project manager. These guys with their crews went over and above and worked so long and so hard to get the job done. Also, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention Mayor Wayne Tuck, heavily involved with the press conference and the whole process that was going on at City Hall during that day as well. So, you know, I'm honored to be able to take this opportunity to thank you. I hate that what had to happen after that, you know, that we recognize you, and I think so often we take for granted the city services that were provided to us, and we just have to be able to say thank you for everything you've done. Yeah, like Will said, May 5th, 2017 is a day that a lot of people will remember for a lot of reasons. Obviously, the people who had property damage will live on with that for a long time. I remember it for how wonderful the community came together. It wasn't just the city, it was the residents, the organizations throughout the city all came together and worked to get this situation fixed as quickly as we could. And as Will described, the tornado coming through at 3:18 in the morning, you know, a lot of times you hear, Eaton just can't catch a break. Well, I believe we caught a break that day. If it had been 3:15 in the afternoon, we'd have had a whole lot of different situations. So I think we, as bad as it was, we caught a break. And I just, like I said before, I just want to thank all the city employees, the workers, the works people that work around the clock, day after day to get things cleaned up, get people back to a normal life as quickly as they could. And as Will mentioned, Mayor Tuggle, he reached out to the governor and sought a state of emergency, and it was granted to us, which as a result, the cleanup that Will was talking about, not only was it expensive, but it was expensive. So by qualifying with the state of emergency, we're able to get back 75% of what we spent on the cleanup by qualifying under the disaster situation we were in. So again, I just want to say thank you to the employees, to everyone else who is involved on behalf of other members of City Council and the city employees. I'd like to say thank you to the Chamber of Commerce for this special recognition. amazing efforts. The city is fortunate to have individuals such as yourself as employees there. Dave, would you like to introduce our speaker? Great.
Good evening. It is my pleasure to introduce our speaker for this evening's dinner, Mr. Chris Ellington. Chris is the president of UNC Healthcare Network Hospitals and the executive vice president of finance for UNC Hospitals at Chapel Hill. He has been listed annually in Becker's Hospital Review as a CFO to know since 2013. He's also been named a top CFO by the Triangle Business Journal and Business Leaders Magazine. Before going to UNC in 2008, Chris was Vice President of Fiscal Services and the Chief Financial Officer for Appalachian Regional Healthcare in Lexington, Kentucky, and also worked in similar executive positions for healthcare systems in Kentucky, West Virginia, and Texas. Chris is very passionate about serving in the community. He serves on the board of the North Carolina Healthcare Association, Carolina Dialysis, and also serves on the boards of the UNC Healthcare affiliated entities in Johnston, High Point, Caldwell, and the UNC Health Alliance. He's an advanced member of the Healthcare Financial Management Association. And that is Chris's bio on paper. What makes Chris so important to me and to the folks in this room is that he was an integral key part of the UNC relationship that we have with the hospital. Chris came on site multiple times, met with our board, met with our management team, and has been determined to make sure that our community has the health care that we need. So he is one of the board members at UNC Rockingham Healthcare, and really, for me, makes this night full circle. 2 years ago, I had the pleasure of talking to you all about Where Promise Flows, and Chris made sure that I was not the liar. And so, because of him, that promise for Eden really, really has come true. So, please join me in welcoming Chris Ellington.
Thank you very much. Many of you told me about the speech Danny gave a couple years ago. This goes poorly. She'll be up here in a few minutes to redo that. I stand up here with a lot of confidence. My daughter called me on the way to work this morning. I have a 19-year-old and 22-year-old, both at NC State. And my youngest called because she left something at home. Many of you that have daughters know that if they left something at home, it's in your wallet is what they left, right? So she asked me what I was doing tonight, which was something, because I told her I wasn't going to be home. What are you doing? And I knew she was just trying to waste time to figure out how she was going to convince my wife to give her the money that I would normally give her. I said I was going to give a speech up in Eden, and she said, really, who turned them down? And I said, no, they called me a while back. I wouldn't talk about healthcare. She said, you're going to wear your Carolina blue tie, aren't you? And I said, I am. Like a teenager would. She said, I figured. And so I don't know if that's good or bad, but anyway, here I am. It's a pleasure to be here. This has been a bit of a longer ordeal and a longer burden for all of you than I wish it had been. Some things have to play out this way, and in this case, it has played out perfectly, although it didn't feel like it, I know, when you were all going through it. It's been a journey, and so now we're starting a new journey. On Friday, we're going to have a bit of a celebration at the hospital. We'll unveil some new signs and the new logo, which you can all see here, and kind of get on with the business of healthcare and why we're all in it to begin with, and that's what UNC is here for. I came to this community in 2013, and it was the first time that I had been here. The hospital at that time was looking for a partner, and I came up with a couple of my colleagues, one of which worked with Dana very closely now, a guy named Matt Smith. And it just wasn't the right time. Some things happened for a reason. We were working with High Point Hospital in Guilford, and they were going through their own financial struggles and how were they going to make it. And we were working with Caldwell Memorial in Lenore, very same issues. They were down to a couple days of cash, and UNC was starting to spread out a little bit. I understand how we can help communities. We're trying to take what we've developed and done in Chapel Hill and then at Rex and Raleigh, try to spread that out. This wasn't the right time at that time. We had too much on our hands. One thing that you'll learn about UNC is we don't brag enough about what we do, but when we do say we're going to do something, we do it. And that's been a big deal for us, and we do need to learn perhaps to brag a little bit more. Healthcare is tough. Margins are tight. You saw that. That's part of what's happened. Small changes in the economy can make tremendous issues. If you don't have a hospital in your community, your economic issues become even greater. You need that. It is a cornerstone of the community. It's for the public good. And that's one of the reasons UNC likes to be involved in rural healthcare. We're still trying to figure it out ourselves. We haven't done that. So we have a really neat opportunity, I think, in Eden to do that. Our mission is to serve all people of North Carolina. We say it, we mean it, and we do things that maybe other institutions won't do. And this may be one of those things, but we're going to figure this out and invest here highly. It's no longer what we do is trying to care for people that are sick or injured. We now have to tend to wellness. There are many wellness initiatives. How do we keep people out of the hospital and the payment mechanisms, how hospitals function, changing how they are. It's complicated, the business of healthcare. The Medicare code itself is bigger than the U.S. tax code. It's bigger than the U.S. our Nuclear Regulatory Commission code, and it needs to be. We're dealing with people, and you want that. It may feel like a lot of regulation, and it's a lot of complexity, but if we're touching people and we're helping heal them and we're doing things to them, you want a safe and caring environment, and we want to make sure we're doing it that way as well. Healthcare's tough. You're seeing the same things that we're seeing. Cost is going up. What's being paid for is going down. Your personal costs are going up. What UNC Healthcare wants to do in Rockingham is figure out a way to increase the value of the services that you get for us, a safe environment. We want a place that you can trust that you can come to have that done. So we're committed to that, and there's some things that we've got to do to get there, and I'll talk about some of those in a little bit in just a minute. I travel across the state quite a bit, and we have a number of hospitals. There are 13 hospitals within UNC Healthcare, all with similar issues and things to overcome. We had a meeting today where we brought all of our leadership teams together, and we talk about things like improving quality, reducing costs, but we not talk about how do we reduce costs necessarily to us. We talk about how do we reduce costs to you. So how do we provide this care as something that's affordable? As I drive around, it also gives me a chance to talk to my parents. Over Christmas, some of these conversations are funny. Over Christmas, my mother introduced me to one of her friends as the guy that signs the paychecks. So, all right, so she doesn't know what I do for a living, but she'll figure it out. And my father corrected her and said, no, he's the one who gets things for the physicians. So neither of them really know what I'm doing. But one of these times I was talking to my father, and I was talking about Eden and what was going on here, and there wasn't much to it. I explained it to him, and that was kind of the end of it. And he asked me about a month ago, he said, how are things going at that Moorhead hospital? And I said, they're going well. Usually we're talking about the birds at the bird feeder, why the postman's 8 minutes late, or something like that. But in this case, I didn't know why he was asking me, but I said, well, now what we're doing is we're asking members of the community what they think about a name change. We're concerned about whether we get the name right. Not Moorhead name has been around a long time, and I didn't know why he was even asking that. We don't typically talk about work, and what I got was I got a history lesson. I got a history lesson about the Moorheads and Eden in Rockingham County. He's the historian of the family, and so it beats talking about politics at home, but we get excruciating detail about the history, and in this case I learned about Captain Joseph Motley, who served with Colonel at the time, George Washington, French and Indian War. So this Captain Motley married, his wife was Martha Ellington. So her father was an uncle. So the Motleys had a daughter named Obedience Ellington called Biddy, who was said to have had majestic appearance that was so beautiful that most people were uncomfortable in her presence. I saw a picture of Biddy Motley, and that is false. It's very, very much not true. So I don't know who wrote it. It had to be a relative. Well, Captain Motley was away at war. His wife, who was Martha Ellington, a descendant of mine, senator, a senator of mine. Betty was in the House that day when a group came up on horseback. They were Tories. The Tories supported the British at the time. Came into the House asking where Earl Motley was, Captain Motley was, where the sons were, where the visions were for the House. The memoir that Obedience had written at the time, Biddy, had written, said that she heard such a clamor she ran to her mother's room to see what was going on and saw her mother being stabbed. And so it killed her, but it said that she was really supported orphans and those without through the rest of her life. She married, and when she married a gentleman named John Moorhead. And so that's the connection to the John Moorhead that all this is named after, and how I'm connected to it. And I had a nice little discussion with my father about this, and about 19 other trees that come off of this as well. So I know all about the family. So my father was very concerned about changing the name and how the Moorheads and the Ellingtons all came together. John Moorhead, John Motley Moorhead, was a UNC graduate in 1817, so it's neat how this kind of comes back together. He was at Rockingham County representative to the North Carolina House of Commons. Many things are named at UNC about him. He was a philanthropist and attorney. He was a friend of General Zachary Taylor, who became president and he was governor, of course. So my rendition of this story might be a little off, but what I'm trying to show you is that we all have connections to Rockingham. We all have our personal reasons for being here tonight. Angela told me there would be a couple people. I did not expect 200 in the park at the top on the grass up there when I got here. Here's what we need to do here. There are a few things that we've got to do to be a little bit more serious about what's going on. We have to invest. We have to invest in the healthcare of your community, and that becomes the healthcare of our community as well. You may not have seen a lot of changes, but there's a lot of things going on that are beyond money. I'm sure it's been in all the papers, and many of you know, we had to pay for the hospital. We didn't want to pay for it. So if there were any concerns about why did UNC suddenly come up with the number they came up with, well, we wanted to pay as little as possible, but we wanted to invest in the community. We weren't investing in other people's issues that they had. We need to grow the physician network. We need more providers. And being associated with UNC will help that. Dr. Alan Stiles is with me, as is Leslie Burnside. Collectively, they really are the brains that help kind of get this together and garner the UNC resources. They also run a professional recruitment division, so they will help bring those physicians to town. These things don't happen quickly. We have to sell the town, we have to sell the facilities, we have to sell our vision. People have to see that we are investing in the community. I was disappointed throughout the bankruptcy process of just what happens in bankruptcy. It's not something that we do. It's cold. We deal with feelings, and we deal with persons, and we touch hands and we shake. Bankruptcy is a code and it's a process. One of the things that happened to the employees here is they lost, maybe not all, but a lot, Dana, of their paid time off. So here they are working at the hospital. The hospital's in bankruptcy. They don't know what their fate's going to be. And at the end of all this, they even lose this accrued time that was to give them time off to recuperate while they're helping all of us recuperate. So we put some time back in their bank. We couldn't replace everything, but we put some time back in their bank to commit to them because we need to take care of our own as well. So later this week, you'll see new signs at the hospital, UNC Rockingham. It's our new start, it's our new beginning, and I told you I was concerned about the name, and I think my father's still concerned about it, but we'll have to get him over that a little bit. We're investing in new equipment. So there was a commitment in purchasing the hospital by UNC. That was a commitment that we had to make through the bankruptcy process. It's not necessarily the full commitment that we'll make to the community. So what we've done is we've sat down with Dana and said, let's come up with a general number just to get the things that we need immediately. Computers, a CT machine, ultrasound machines, whatever clinical equipment's necessary. Please clean up the grounds and win a beautification award next year, if you would. That would be good. Those kind of basic things. And so we said, how does $4 million sound? Let's start with that. We put money into a bank account to make sure that no one has to worry about getting paid, our staff that are there. We want to make sure the community knows that the place is going to be stable. So we've got to get that piece done, and I think we've done that. We're planning to reopen the Cancer Oncology Center. It takes a little bit more work now. So we need radiation. We have some commitments from some of the UNC physicians in Chapel Hill. We need radiation oncology. We need
physicists. There are a number of things. There are some code issues that we have to deal with to make sure things are right there, but that is happening now. I mentioned the replacement of the CT machine, same thing. We have to now redesign a room to get this ordered, but that should be going on. You're now going to have direct access to the specialists and the subspecialists that we have at UNC and Chapel Hill and at Rex and at other places, and that direct access is going to be a lot better. We can't provide everything in Rockingham, I think you know that, but we can bring a lot more to the community than what you've had before. You don't have to get all your health care done here, and we're not asking for that. There are times when you may feel better going to a different place, or you may feel like it's better for you, and I think you should go there. There are things that you can do here, even if you go somewhere else. And it's the theme of why everyone's here. Buy local, shop local if you can. Give us a try. We need to earn your trust, and we need to build that trust. Let's see. We're going to also, for our staff, restart their retirement program. You can see some of this investment is in us to make sure that we're doing the right things. The retirement plans had to end as a result of this bankruptcy, and so around the March time frame, when we get all the right mechanisms put in, we will maintain our employees' years of service. So they get credit for everything that they've done here. Again, we're trying to build that foundation internally and earn some of this trust. Longer term, that's really where this is going to get excited. We've got to make changes. We've got to do something innovative. We don't know what that is yet. We've been here 1 month. So the bankruptcy process really was a financial process. We're all over here staring this way. Now we're running the healthcare. So we will go through a strategic planning process. We need the board that we already have in place. We'll add a few new members to that board. We will bring strategic planning folks from UNC. It's nice working for a company that has 35,000 employees because there's depth and there's experts. And it's not folks that just stand up at a microphone and talk to you. It's people that really know how to do work. So we'll get them involved. But that's our next body of work. It'll take us a couple months before we start that, just because we're still getting into the rhythm of how to do things. We were talking just a couple minutes ago about the nursing home that's here, which will be also renamed the Rehabilitation Nursing Center. There are things in that nursing home that are better than the way that we do them in the facilities that we currently have. And we need to get Michael down there to show us how to do those things, and then can learn the things that we might do a little bit better than are being done up here. We do that with all of our facilities, and that's one of the things that, the reasons that we brought everybody together today that Dana and others were there for, is as we're talking about improving quality, now there are people to reach out to, so we don't recreate the wheel, we try to become a little bit more efficient. We've got to answer questions for ourselves about, do we need a new facility? Can we build on the current footprint? It's not out of the range of possibilities to build an entirely new hospital. I think there's a good footprint there. The emergency department is set up beautifully. Maybe we can build off of that. But the current building, just because of its age, isn't really set up for the next 15 and 25 years of healthcare. So that's going to take some significant planning and some significant thought before we put shovels in the ground. Should we have medical students and residents here? Another great thing to have. Medical students are terrific, and so are residents, because they keep us all on our toes. They're learning. They're in a learning environment. We've got to learn a little bit faster than they are. We need our medical community to help support that, and we'll facilitate that. What medical specialties are needed in the community? What medical specialties should we share with other communities? When should we grab folks from UNC Healthcare to come up and have clinics for a day, 2 days, a whole week? All need to be decided. What do we need to add? What do we need to supplement? We need to explore all of this. So let me just end with this, and again, I know there are better speakers. I appreciate you having me. I can just tell you genuinely from myself, we've invested in our staff, and we're going to continue to do that. We will invest in the footprint and the bricks and the medical equipment and all that. We can do all that. We will change the culture to be a little bit more aligned with UNC's. I don't think we're far off, and that's do the right thing. You don't have to go through layers of approvals to do the right thing. Dana gives a couple speeches about Oakland Hospital and what they do. That's what we want here, because that's what's going to want you to come and use our services. When I was here a month ago with Leslie and Alan, we observed a couple of folks that do what you want people to do. I saw people stand and hold the door open for folks that I know they didn't know. I saw employees picking things up off the floor. These are just doing the right things. These are things that you want them to do. And that translates into care as well. So we will do all those things. We want to earn your trust. You have to tell us what we're doing wrong. I don't mind the constructive criticism. I don't mind the bills aren't right. It takes too long to do this. You're not doing this right. Tell us, and then give us a chance to fix it. And we'll do it. Everybody wants to do the right thing. There's not a single person at that facility that I've met that doesn't want to improve on what they're doing, doesn't want to show off what they're doing to everybody in this room. So we're here for you. We came willingly. We came because we wanted to. We're glad UNC Rockingham is part of our family now. And hopefully that you've seen, Dana, that we're treating you just like everybody that's been around forever. There's nothing off limits that you can't go for. We're just trying to slow you down a little bit. That's all. we're going to get there. I'm available, as is anybody from my company, with any concerns that you have or anything that you'd like to see us do. But again, we'll be reaching out to many of you to get some ideas on what you think is needed in the community, and then we'll do it together. So thank you for having me, and you've also given me a chance to do a little genealogy with my father, which was terrific, and it's just a pleasure to be here. So thank you all very much.
Evening. In the summer of 2015, Mohawk Industries was making a decision to either expand the Eden Karistan facility with its aircraft carpet division or retain that operation at a South Carolina facility. Either the Eden facility would expand or close. There were no other choices. As all companies do, Mohawk sought an incentive package to assist in this expansion. At the time, the North Carolina industrial incentives were minimal due to changes in the Department of Commerce. When we presented our case to Mohawk on a Thursday conference call, it was readily apparent that Eden, Rockingham County, and North Carolina were not in the same ballpark as our neighbors to the south. The plant would close, and with it all the jobs, unless something changed. And I'll tell you, it's a very sobering experience. Dan Kreitz, Ken Allen were there. You instantly start thinking about your friends and all their shattered lives. So I immediately called the office of Senator Phil Berger and asked for an emergency meeting the next morning. The meeting was scheduled, and we presented the dire situation to Senator Berger. From that point on, Phil took the project under his wing, and the Eden facility was saved. Plus, more than 100 new jobs from the expansion resulted, and a company that turns 90 this year is still a vibrant part of the Eden industrial community. Since 2001, the city of Eden has spent $40 million repairing its sewer system to reduce wastewater overflow. That has resulted in over 95% reduction in those overflows. You would think that if any organization improved its performance by more than 95%, they would be considered as doing a good job. Not by the EPA. They have demanded no sanitary sewer overflows and are requiring the city of Eden to spend another $33 million in the next 5 years to achieve this goal, which is really unreachable. And if you ignore the EPA, you face daily fines of $37,500. Unless the city received help, the results would be significant water increases that would have seriously hurt residents and businesses alike. Eden was not the only North Carolina city in this situation. Recognizing the potential catastrophic impact of this type of unfunded mandate on Eden and other North Carolina communities, Senator Berger provided the Connect Bond Initiative funds in there for those communities to help provide relief for those suffering the weight of such a financial burden. We've just heard the very exciting plans of UNC Rockingham Healthcare provided by Chris Ellington. UNC Rockingham Healthcare is a vital part of the Eden community. It's its largest employer and a critical institution for future Eden growth. Yet its very existence was very much in doubt in 2017. The hospital was in jeopardy of shutting down before UNC Healthcare stepped in. And Senator Berger was a strong supporter of the UNC Healthcare acquisition of Morehead Hospital. Today, the more than 700 employees working there have a solid foundation upon which to build as UNC Rockingham Healthcare embarks on becoming the premier healthcare facility in this region. One of Senator Berger's aides told me that Phil is not a typical politician. He does not seek the limelight. He goes about his business doing what he thinks is best for North Carolina. Phil is also a politician who does not forget who sent him to Raleigh. He has never forgotten Eden or Rockingham County, as you've just heard. The award I am presenting tonight is for the Member of the Year, the individual organization that promotes commerce in the Eden community. For his support of the Eden business community and Eden citizens in general, I can think of no one who is more deserving of this award than our Senator Phil Berger, and it's my honor to bestow this long overdue award on him tonight. I heard earlier that everybody's limited to 3 minutes other than Chris. Chris's remarks were right on point, and I want to thank the chamber, and I especially want to thank the people of Eden and Rockingham County. 1984, Pat and I moved to Eden in a U-Haul truck, and the only thing I knew was that I was going to try to practice law and raise a family. This has been a great place. So thank you very much.
All right. Next award, the Distinguished Citizen Award. Let me get to it. The 2017 Distinguished Citizen Award was awarded to an individual that I simply could not believe had not won this award in the past. This year's recipient has been involved in so much for so many years, I would have bet good money that they were a previous winner. As a local business owner, they have constantly donated whatever is needed to the community, be it financial or merchandise sponsorships, free wellness education classes for the community on topics such as diabetes, heart health, and nutrition, or heading up an annual book bag with school supplies to 2,000 needy children throughout Rockingham County. Pete Crouch definitely puts the well-being of the local community as a priority in his life. 12 years ago, with his wife Debbie, Pete fulfilled a career-long dream of purchasing his own pharmacy. When many were looking forward towards retirement, Pete was giving 110% to make Eden Drug a pharmacy destination. Owning his own pharmacy gave him the freedom to provide excellent patient care no matter what it took. Pete and Eden Drug now employ 40 people, and he has instilled his vision of keeping patients healthy, happy, and giving back to the local community. Pete's commitment to this community inspired Eden Drug employees to raise $14,000 all by themselves for the Relay for Life in 2017. Other charities supported or the Cooperative Christian Ministry Food Pantry, Christmas Sponsorship for Foster Children, the American Red Cross Food Supplies and Fans for the Elderly, RCC Sponsorship, and the Rockingham County Education Foundation. Currently, Pete serves on several boards, including local YMCA, Board of Directors of the Hospital, and Prescribed Wellness and Pharmacy Development Services. Pete also served 4 years on the Eden Chamber of Commerce Board and was our chairman in 2014. Unfortunately, Pete couldn't be here with us tonight, but I would ask you all to please join me in congratulating Pete as his wife Debbie and daughter Amanda come forward to accept this well-deserved award on his behalf. Teach you to plan a business trip on the night of a chamber event. Tell him that. He always needs to check with the local chamber to make sure the dates don't clash with anything. He did. Another well-deserved award. Congratulations. Sylvia, would you please come up and present the next award?
I'm going to do this a little bit different tonight. because you're going to know immediately who I'm talking about. So I will tell you that the Distinguished Service Award tonight goes to a couple, honored as one, Ann and Neil Thayer. D.C. He was a captain in the U.S. Air Force Civil Air Patrol. Neil came back to Eden to go into the funeral home business with his father, which his grandfather had started. And this was to Eden's great advantage. Very active in the community, Neil has been president of multiple organizations. To name a few, the Rockingham County Airport Authority, he is a pilot, obviously. The Rotary Club, the Chamber of Commerce, the YMCA, the JCs, the Eden United Way, and because the hospital is here tonight, he was also chairman of the Moorhead Hospital Trustees. He has served on the RCC Foundation, the Red Cross, the Partnership for Economic Development. He presently serves on the Hospice Board, and on the BB&T board. And this is in addition to his real job as owner and president of the Fair Funeral Home. And now Ann. Ann serves on the board of the Boys and Girls Club. She is very active in the Leakesville United Methodist Church and the city's Eden Appearance Commission. But the big deal is she has served on the YMCA as a volunteer at the YMCA for 30 years. She came there as a fitness director. And the big deal was, though, she was an aerobics instructor there. Now, aerobics was a new word 30 years ago. And she actually made aerobics into an art form. Barry Mays said that she started when she started teaching aerobics there, she people started joining the YMCA so they could be in Ann's aerobics class. Except you might join the YMCA, but you had to get on this list to be in Ann's aerobics class. And so she was the popular one. And he said he got a lot of YMCA members, but they all couldn't get in her class. Barry said that Ann was the YMCA's biggest cheerleader. Now, that's what they did separately. But together, they touched this community in a couple really powerful ways. They remodeled a family home next to their funeral home. And they made this available for community functions, people who may want to use it for community functions, and also for families that they may serve. It's a beautiful home and a historic home named Moorhead Fair House. Ann and Neil together, though, worked to provide a Memorial Day service at this home in honor of local veterans. And a lot of times they even go and pick the veterans up and bring them to the service if they can't get there on their own. And they've been lucky when it's possible They've been blessed with beautiful weather, and this home has a great big porch on the outside, and the speakers are up on this porch, and everybody is sitting out on the beautiful lawn, and they're in chairs, and they're on mats, and they're sitting in the grass, and they're honoring the veterans in our community. I call it Americana. But the real Americana is what they do for the 4th of July. Anne and Neil's daughter, when she was very young, wanted to have a 4th of July parade. And that very young daughter is a grown woman now. And they come back, her whole family comes back into town, their whole family come back into town, and they have the Eden's 4th of July parade. Now, anybody in here from Eden knows about this 4th of July parade? Because it has become something that an Eden person would never miss. Hundreds line up at their funeral home, while hundreds more line the streets and watch and cheer the people who are marching in the parade. Homes along the parade path are draped in America. Their yards and their streets are filled as they watch the Eden community. Children and parents and grandparents and neighbors and friends and horses and dogs, and last year I saw a mom. They're riding in convertibles, and they're pushing babies in strollers, and they're golf carts everywhere, and bikers young and old, and hundreds just watching the parade. All the paraders are vying for the prize. They give away a lot of prizes. But they're vying for a prize, and the judges are up at the funeral home where the parade started. Everybody is lining up in this community to see and to be a part of that parade. Now, at the end of the parade, if you have been a part of the parade, not a viewer, but if you've been a part of the parade, you are then invited back to the funeral home for watermelon in the parking lot. I don't think it's ever rained on that parade. It's never rained on that parade.
Yes.
It rained.
But it stopped.
I didn't know it. I remember it sprinkled one time, but it never really rained on that parade. We should all be so proud to have Ann and Neil Fair in our community, and they have surely earned the Distinguished Service Award. Come on.
You don't leave. Tried to sneak out on us. You were caught.
Right.
Thank you. Okay. We're flying. Couple things left to do. I want to recognize the outgoing board members. Thank you for everything that you guys have done. Many of you, a 3-year term to serve on this board, many of you, if you had been the chairman, you get that fourth year. I know it's too good to turn down sometimes. But for those of you who have served either 3 or 4 years, you know, a sincere thank you. You've seriously done a tremendous service to your community. Very much appreciated. I would like to recognize the following outgoing board members. So with the following individuals, please come forward. We got Debbie Ellis, Joy Toms, Orlando Petit, and Constance Florence. Now, I believe Debbie and Orlando are the only two here.
Get all the four.
Messed up. She said she'd still be around. Little does she know, you sit off for 1 year and then you're eligible to come back. Watch out. Okay. So we need to replace these openings with some new board members. So with the following individuals, please come forward. Karen Baker with Gildan Activewear. Tony Edwards, Carolina Doombug. Tara Farges with First Citizens Bank. Melissa Cassidy Scheidel with Ameristat. Laurie Southern with Goodwill Community Resource Center. And Rochelle Davis Turner with Family Eye Care. If you're here this evening, please come forward. Chamber of Commerce, friends, and family to install the newly elected members of the Board of Directors. Guys, you've been elected to serve as directors of the Chamber. If each of you will commit to the following, please answer, "I will," after all commitments have been presented. Attend as many board meetings as possible. Help establish programs, objectives, and policies of the Chamber. Assist in fundraising projects to meet the budget, manage the assets, build the membership, and actively promote the Chamber in our community. I now declare and proclaim the new directors of the Eden Chamber of Commerce for the years 2018 through 2020 duly and legally installed. Congratulations to each one. Next month, 7:30 in the morning. New guys bring donuts. All right, about ends me. So, as I'm calling next year's chairman, Mr. Phillip Raeburn up, past the gavel, and actually it'd be just my handshake, I guess. Your right hand. I want to say a quick thank you for the opportunity that the Chamber has given me to chair this board and the trust that you have in me. Chair this board. You know, I've been involved in the Chamber. I think this is probably my 10th year as being on the board. I was the chair in 2010 as well, so this is kind of old hat. But I truly enjoy it. When I see what the Chamber has done and continues to do, will do in the future, it really makes me feel good. You know, when you love a community and you have a lot of faith and you want to see a community succeed, you get behind an organization like the Chamber. You support them, you'll be amazing what can happen in the community. So I want to thank Randy. Randy was the president of the Chamber for the first 6 months of 2017. Moved on to a different job, but I want to thank you for the opportunity to serve as the chair. Really appreciate all your support and advice and everything that you've provided. Heather, where is she? You know, you called the backbone of the Chamber earlier, and you know, that's a very true statement. It's amazing what you get done around over there. A lot of times you have some help, but whether you have any help or not, go ahead and get it done. And it's very encouraging to know that you're over there. If something were to happen, somebody needs to take some time off or whatever, you're there. You can carry the ball, you've proven you have, and we really appreciate everything that you do. And Angela, our new president, for the last 6 months of 2017. Again, I've really enjoyed getting to know you the last 6 months, and I'm very excited and very encouraged with where the Chamber is now and where I can see it being under your leadership, Phillip's leadership, and this board over the next several years. It is very encouraging and very exciting. So, thank you. You came right in the middle. I don't know if you knew what a chamber did when you took the job, but that didn't let, stop you from learning. You know, the temptations was thrown right into your lap when you got here. Tackled it with the help of several board members. It turned out fantastic. Continue to recruit new membership and put it on this one for me. Just done a fantastic job and really appreciate everything you've done. So, again, thank you guys. I enjoyed it. I'll pass the gavel. Phillip?
Well, we're not done yet. We have one more award. It's actually a real gavel, so I guess I'll get one next year if I live. But thank you so much for your leadership, and thank you so much for your service here at the Chamber. We all respect you, we all love you, and we just thank you. Lay your out, and we'll come back and get you again. Thank you. So I was a little nervous because I only had 3 to 5 minutes to speak. And so I was like, man, so I set a fourth grader down and a fifth grader down and said, hey, let me give you a speech. And they, after the speech, they said, Phillip, I think it's really boring. And I think that they're gonna fall asleep anyway, so they're gonna forget about the time. So don't fall asleep. And I'm really excited about this. Before we talk about plans for 2018, and I think for me that's vision. So I want to start this conversation off with a quote. Not all dreamers are winners, but all winners are dreamers. Your dream is the key to your future. Without a vision, a dream, the people perish. You need a dream if you're going to succeed and do anything. Vision for 2018 is a vast and difficult topic to express in such a small amount of time. But there are a few values and ideas I'd like to articulate for our Chamber. Many things in this world can misdirect our vision from our goals and our love and passion for our purpose. However, our board and Chamber are here to clearly state who we are and what we are. First, we are here to fight for you, for this city, for your purpose. The Chamber in 2018 is here to unite our businesses and to value them with the highest regard. We are here for you in 2018. It's simple. It's not brain surgery. It's not chemistry. We are here for you. We are here to serve, not to be served. And our chamber wants to meet you where you are and your business right where they are. If that's from our new hospital, UNC Rockingham, or to the local business that has one employee with no website or even a social media presence, our goal is to continue to help with networking, marketing, and in 2018, lead the way in technological growth. That can be from creating a website or to help grow your social media presence. Let's take a look at our friendly online store, Amazon. They've completely transformed the word Prime. If you aren't sure what that is, just take 1 second and ask your neighbor, and they will tell you. They've created drones to drop packages off at residences. They've even created huge amounts of anger in us when packages come on the third day when it's definitely promised 2-day shipping. We all have been affected by this wave of success. Just back in 2018, they've had a small $61 billion in net assets. Now, let's jump to 2016, where Amazon has showed a whopping $135 billion in net sales. In just 4 years, they've more than doubled their profit. Now, I understand that on a large scale, we can ponder how this is even possible in Eden. However, let's learn from this giant and bring some of the philosophies to our city. For me, one of our main obstacles is technology. Our chamber wants to lead for the future, and the future, in my opinion, is technology. Let's dream about the possibilities, create a sturdy vision, then together we can execute as a team for our small businesses in Eden. Another value I see that will help greatly and bring us back to our roots is unity. United is a term that we greatly understand. It's a term our founding fathers chose to use for our nation. We are united under one law, under one constitution, and for our chamber, we want our cities and our businesses, our schools, and our citizens to be united under one chamber. We want this to be the leading entity and the unity in Eden. This vision is easy to execute when we communicate clearly and focus on what we are doing right in our city. The Chamber wants to lead this direction, and we invite you to be a part of this. Finally, our Chamber in 2018 will strongly advocate for you and your business. We want to be your biggest cheerleader. We in the Chamber will work our hardest to be the champion of influence on community issues and for your business. Our Chamber and Board will continue to provide ongoing training and educational experiences, and we are also open to your opinions and questions in the future. So to end, I have two questions. How can we fight for you? And how can you fight with us? We are a team. If your goal is to articulate your cause, let us inspire the message. If your goal is to become more technologically advanced, ask us, and we want to make that happen. If your goal is to network with other businesses, let us lead you. We are excited about 2018. Let's work. Let's fight together for our chamber and for our city. We at the chamber are only successful when our partners are successful. Remember, we are here for you, united as one and partnered with many. Let's make 2018 the best year yet. Thank you so much for this opportunity. Thank you for your continued partnership, and thank you for this amazing board. God bless you all, and you can't leave yet because I was reading in the board. You have to pick up a 2018 Chamber of Commerce business directory. So do not forget that. But we thank you all for being here. We're honored to be your chamber and to be your board, and you are definitely dismissed by 8:49.